Hello YouTube, Dragonheart, the Prince of Wales, and welcome to a tutorial video for beginners for Total War Attila. This has been a video that's been requested by quite a few people on my channel. And before we crack on with this tutorial, on the screen right now you'll see three clickable links. They will be thumbnails to my previous tutorial videos. They're beginner's guides for Medieval 2 Total War, for Rome 2 Total War, and Shogun 2 Total War. If you're watching on a desktop, then you can click on them and it will take you to those videos. But anyway, this is Total War Attila, and what this guide will be doing is giving brand new players of the Total War franchise a basic overview, basic guide, and basically a good first point of call for getting started with Total War Attila. So this is the screen that you will be greeted with when you start off Attila. Now if you look here, we've got low campaign, got prologue, grand campaign, the last Roman, Age of Charlemagne, and multiplayer. Now the last Roman and Age of Charlemagne are both DLCs. We're not going to worry about them today, okay? We've got the grand campaign, which is what we're going to be looking at. But what I would advise before jumping into a grand campaign is going on to the prologue first and go through the prologue in its entirety before going on a grand campaign. That will just get you familiar with some of the basic controls and the mechanics of the game. Multiplayer is probably a little bit more advanced. I'd definitely try and do a single player campaign first before you jump onto the multiplayer scene. Now other options, the two swords crossing here, historical battles, so if you click on that, you can click on any of these. So you've got the Battle of Catalunian Plains. It gives you like a historical overview of some of the stuff that has gone on in Total War, in history actually. So you can play them, you can play on different difficulties and try and get Steam achievements and stuff, and they are quite fun to play, and as you can see, it's on a map of the known world at that time. We have custom, which you can make your own custom battles, multiplayer, quick battle if you just want to jump in and play somebody randomly online. You've got online leaderboards, and you've got replays. When you play online, you can save replays, you can rewatch them then through that tab. Then you have the options guide, so I'm just going to go into graphics. I'm going to show you my graphics at the moment, just to kind of give you an idea of what I'm running. So you can see graphics card, I got an NVIDIA GeForce GTX 970, video memory is there, over 3000 MB, anti-aliasing MLAA, got texture resolution on ultra, I got anthropomorphic 16, or x16, max quality, which is the highest you can get for shadows, water and sky. They give different tabs, you can have max performance, performance quality, quality. So max performance would be lower quality as far as viewing, but higher quality as far as your PC's performance. Depth of field I've got turned on, particle effects, max quality, screen space is off, max quality in all of these, grass, trees, terrain, unit details and building details. Unit size I've got on ultra, which is the highest you can have, porthole quality I've just got on 3D, unlimited memory is ticked, distortion is ticked, and blood effects. I would definitely recommend playing around with some of these. And also a quick side note, the blood effects, you don't actually have that when you purchase the game, you do have to purchase that as a DLC. I believe it's in the region of about £2 as far as UK money goes, so it'll be around about that. You can run a benchmark as well just to double check your frames per second, etc. As I'm recording this right now on the screen, I'm getting about 240 frames per second, so quite insane stuff, but obviously I'm not really playing anything. And also we have a Total War Encyclopedia here, if you want to check that out on this little scroll tab by here. That will actually give you some of the basic building types, unit types and stuff that you can run through in your own time. But anyway, like I said, we're going to go onto this top tab here. It's got a little map of Europe. We're going to go into Grand Campaign. And this is what it looks like once you jump onto it. So there are different types of subcultures here. Nomadic tribes, Roman Empire, Eastern Empires, Great Migrators, Barbarian Kingdoms, Norsemen, Celts, and Desert Kingdoms. They're the different subcategories. So Nomadic Tribes, click on it, and it gives you two options, the White Huns and the Huns. And they're the two. You have Roman Empire, so you have the Western Roman Empire and the Eastern Roman Empire. On Eastern Empires, at the moment, we have the Sassanid Empire. Great Migrators, quite a few to pick from. Here you've got the Alans, the Swabians, the Vandals, the Ostrogoths, and the Visigoths. Barbarian Kingdoms, then you have the Franks, you have the Alemans, the Langobards, the Burgundians, and the Saxons. Norsemen, which is the Viking factions, you have the Jutes, the Danes, and the Geats. Celts, you have the Ibdanians, the Caledonians, and the Picts. And then the Desert Kingdoms, we have Himyar, the Tanakids, Axum, and the Lachmids. And each faction gives you a rundown of their faction leader and their religion, plus some traits. So for example, in the case of the Lachmids, cultural traits, so scorched earth, plus 2 sanitation for all regions, attrition, immune to desert attrition, and Scourge of the Desert, plus 15 melee attack during desert battle. So if they fight in the desert with these, they're going to be quite strong, quite formidable. If you fight in the snow, up north somewhere, in the north maybe, in the Norselands, they're not going to be quite as effective. So each faction has these different things. Now for this tutorial, I'm going to be going with the Roman factions, and I'm going to be going with the biggest faction, which is one I have a lot of experience playing with, and that is the Western Roman Empire. So it gives you the faction leader here, Flavius Honorius Augustus, religion Latin Christian. You've got a little bit of a description here which you can scroll down to read. It gives you the start here, and the initial challenge is legendary. Now this is actually the hardest faction to play as in the game. I'm only going to show you the opening turn or two in this beginner's tutorial guide, but I'm going to give you a basic rundown how to play as them. Now I'm going to be playing this on I'm going to go with normal difficulty. Now I actually play on very hard or legendary. They're the two that I usually play on. And this campaign, I have a playlist on my channel where I played on legendary and did about 20-21 episodes on it altogether. So I have got lots of experience on the hardest difficulty with this faction. But for the sake of the tutorial, and because it's a beginner's guide, it's going to be on normal, just to give you a basic run through. Now, cultural trait, Imperial Allegiance. So they can levy units from friendly hordes passing through Roman territory. And their faction trait is Cultural Integration. They get an upkeep cost rather of -2% per non-Roman unit in a military force. Constant immigration and public order penalties, -50% of immigration. So that's quite a good thing to go for. Now, in the bottom right-hand corner, you've got campaign settings. Advisor help, I got on none, but I'd recommend any new-time players to have it on low or high at least, just for the opening, probably, campaign that you do. And show AI player moves, I got it on limited, but you can have that off or on full. Auto save the cloud if you want to do that. I've got mine checked off, can I do mine manually? Battle realism, I would keep that off if it's your first campaign, but as you go on, you could probably tick that. And battle time limit, you can have 20, 40 or 60. I would definitely have it probably 40 or 60. Most battles though, you'd probably be over under 20 minutes, but a siege battle will take longer, so I just have it on the 60. And then we have this little trophy here, it's victory objectives. You click on that, a minor victory can be achieved by surviving until the following date, which is spring 425. We start off in 395, so that's 30 years basically. Control 80 settlements either by direct ownership or through satrapies and military allies. And maintain control of the following three provinces either by direct ownership or through puppet states and military allies. Venetia, Liguria and Italia. So basically hold Italy. Research 10 technologies, produce the following amount of wealth from all buildings and maintain 70 units in total. As you go up then, you've got higher goals you can achieve. So cultural victory then, spring 450, you've got more settlements, more provinces, more building types and more certain types of buildings. So you've got a lot more stuff to do for cultural victory, and the same then for the military victory, more stuff you have to do. And then the last one then is a divine triumph, which is basically a domination victory where you control most of the map basically. Most of the regions, or most of the big regions at least. And you have to do a lot, a hell of a lot. It'd take hours and hours to get to that probably. Okay, so guys, this is what we're going to do. We're going to jump in now on this campaign. So start campaign, and I'll talk to you as it loads up. It shouldn't take too long to load up. My loading times aren't too bad. I do have 2 terabytes of hard drive space and an SSD. If you are interested in what my computer setup is, on my About page, on my YouTube channel, I have a full rundown of all my parts. So just to give you an idea of what PC I'm running to run this game. As I already mentioned, I do have a GTX 970. And it does mean that I can do some pretty cool stuff when I zoom in. I can make machinimas if I want to. I can enjoy the game in a good kind of graphical sense. And I would also recommend having a good processor. I mean, you can get by on a lower graphics card than what I've got. I definitely recommend checking out Steam and checking out the minimum requirements for this game. But I definitely, you know, I'd go processor over graphics card for this type of game, because the graphics aren't the most important thing. The processor is the important thing, because this game can be a bit of a resource hog sometimes. So that's just my 2 cents on the matter, really. Just in case you were thinking of purchasing this game and you're watching this video as a kind of, something to maybe entice you to buy it or not. I mean, I'm not going to tell you whether you should or not. I'm just going to tell you in this campaign, in this tutorial, how to play the game. So I'm just going to skip this by here. I'm skipping that for a reason, and that is because I've seen it a million times. I'm going to skip that as well. And before we crack on, I'll just say that first thing I skipped is basically the standard intro you get for any faction you play as on Total War Tiller. If you watch any campaign or most campaigns on YouTube now, they all have that same... it's about a 3-minute video just going through Attila being born and everything. So just going to save you time and skip that. And the second thing I skipped then was the advisor. He just gives you a brief kind of overview. He goes around the map like this and he basically says what your faction's currently doing, blah, 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 and what you could be doing, blah, 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 blah. It just gives you like a brief thing of the year and certain alliances that you have at the start of a campaign. So the very first thing that's popped up on the screen as we start this campaign is mission issued. Chapter 1, preparation. They made ready for war. Objective is to survive until the following date, Spring 400. So if I survive 5 years, it's 395 AD. I survive 5 years, I get a bonus of 2,000 denarii in my treasury. So that's awesome. So this is what we are greeted with on the campaign map, and it is quite a big map. I can scroll in with my mouse wheel, I can scroll out as far as this with my mouse wheel. If I hold down the mouse wheel, I can scroll around the map like so. And I, as I said, it's a very big map. Got Britain all the way up there. We have Spain down here. We have North Africa by here. We have quite a lot of land in our empire, as you can see. And a good way to bring up your empire as well, if I show you on the mouse right now, where, next to where it says End Term, we have another toggle here that says Strategic Overview. Click on that. It brings you, and you can use the, you know, you can use the mouse wheel again to scroll in and out. But it brings you up this screen, and everything that's red and got my logo on it is mine. We have most of Britain, or half of Britain. We have Spain, North Africa, like I said, Italy, France, and parts of Germania, and it ends there on the border. So that's what we currently start with. And in the purple, that is the Eastern Roman Empire, who start off as our allies. So in total, that is the former Roman Empire in its entirety, pretty much. But you'll see the map is greyed out. That is the fog of war. You need to discover certain factions and explore these regions to know who holds these regions or not. As you can see, owner unknown in most of these regions. It'll give you the region name, but it won't give you the owner. Although up here, we do know that the Jutes are there and the Geats are there. That's because we have some sort of trade, or we have them at the start of the campaign in some sort of capacity. As you can see, Alabu is there. That is the Jutes, and then the Geats are there. I think the Danes start off around there as well. And Flevum, look at the Franks. Lots of different factions. Now, I would definitely recommend not doing the West Roman Empire as your first campaign, because they are massive, as you can see. I'm just showing you this in the tutorial, because if you can take away parts of this tutorial into your own campaigns, then you'll be set, pretty much. Because this is the hardest one. You're fighting on so many fronts. If I just bring you to this tab at the bottom, it's got Diplomacy. Click on Diplomacy. So with the yellow is me. Now, you've got different things here. I'm on the left-hand side. The person I'm talking to is on the right-hand side. Now, I've got attitude, trade, treaties, region, strength, and faction. So if I click on faction, it will do it in alphabetical order. Strength, whoever's got the numbers, that the lowest are the better faction. So Eastern Roman Empire, rank 2. I'm probably rank 1 because I have the most regions. Rank 3 is the Sassanid Empire. Rank 5 are the Huns, 7 the Franks, and 8 are the Geats. Regions, click on that. Eastern Roman Empire have 38, the Sassanids have 10, Armenia has 3, and then the rest are probably single, or apart from the Garamantians, the rest are all single factions, or single region factions. Treaties, the same thing, click on that. So as you can see, the Saxons were at war with, the Jutes were at war with, the Quadians were at war with, and the Ostrogoths were at war with. We start off at war with 4 different factions. If I scroll down, Eastern Roman Empire, we have a military access. I'm a military alliance. They are my allies, and I can walk on their lands, they can walk on my lands, and there won't be any penalties. We have military access to Nabatea and Lazica. We also have a non-aggression pact with the Franks. Is that the Yazyges, or Lazyges, I think it's pronounced. I'm not quite sure, to be honest. And if you hover there, you see they've got a little wheel that says they're a horde. That means they don't have a region, but they will roam around the campaign map and try and settle. So the Swabians are the same, they have it there, as you can see with the cursors right now. Same with the Visigoths, but there. Same with the Ostrogoths and the Huns, but there. So, just little things you can look at. So, trade, if I click on that and scroll up to the top, all of these are blank. That means I can trade with them. These are all red. It means I can't trade with them. Obviously, I'm at war, so I can't trade with them if I'm at war with them. These ones I can't trade, probably because I hover over a sea route from their capital cannot be established. And then the ones that are green are the factions I'm already trading with. So that's the trade explained there. And attitude, if I go on that, So by here, the faction that loves us the most are the Eastern Roman Empire, and if you hover over the little smiley face, it tells you why. So, treaties with the Eastern Roman Empire 95, cultural affinity 5, total plus 100. Because I'm a great power, they don't like that so much. They don't like my religious aversion, obviously there's slightly different religions with the two of us. And the gifts I've given to some of their enemies as well, they don't like. But as you can see, the total attitude is 49, it's going to be 50 next turn, and it's friendly and it's improving. So, nothing to worry about with that faction. Nobutea, the Ghassanids, and some of the other factions here are all yellow or amber. Now, as you can see, these are improving, so maybe in a few turns' time I can get some sort of treaty with Nobutea. If I click on them, it shows me where they are. So this is a good thing to do as well. If you click on certain factions, it shows you where they are in the world. And if a faction... I mean, what we'll do, I'll try and show you how to use the diplomacy. So if we go with Nobutea, for example, they're down here. They're right below the Eastern Roman Empire, who are, of course, our military allies and friends. So if we click on this by here, initiate diplomacy. Greetings, now, it gives you my current treaty over there, which is military access. If I click on add offer / demand, these gives me the options. I can arrange a marriage, payment, or declare war. I'll try and arrange a marriage. I have a daughter I can offer. So this is Julia Flavianus. She's 18. Protective, so gives her some of her stats here, plus 1 per turn for personal influence, and plus 10 chance of being wounded aggressors. So, not a bad daughter to have. I can click on her ticket. Likelihood of success, moderate. What I try to do, I try to get something in return. So, payments, I demand that you give me, we'll say 900. It's low, but offer it though. And they reject it. But of course, you can mess around with this and try and get the best diplomacy deal that you can. I'm just going to cancel this and cancel that, and that's basically the diplomacy. Next to that, we have technology down by here, which has a little exclamation mark. We click on that, this is a technology tree. The top tree is military, the bottom tree is civic. Now, anything that has a tick by it has already been researched. So as you can see, two turns, I can get functional specialization. That will enable the building of a cavalry corral, a skirmisher range, and an infantry grounds. It also unlocks the recruitment of the Comitinensis Spears, and they replace the Limitanei Border Guards, which are much better units, of course. Or I can go for a civic thing and go for classical philosophy. That means I get minus one corruption in my faction. I'm going to go with the military, though, because I want to get the spear units. So I'm just going to click on them, and that will tell me it will take two turns to research that. I can go higher up, though. I can go for Protectors Domestici. Domestici. They replace the Palatine Guards. And I get an upkeep cost of minus 10% for melee infantry. Or I can go for the ammunition, plus 5 with the military provisions. And that gives me armor, blacksmith, and carpenter. And that sounds pretty cool. If I click on that, it means that I will be researching this in two turns, the functional specializations. And then 5 turns after that, I'll be researching that. In total, it'll take me 7 turns to get to that point of the tree. And then I can go to payment in kind. And that will be 8 turns, so it'll be 2, then 5, then an 8. And then I can come back around then, once I've done all those 3, and get the hereditary service. That will be the first part of the tree done. And then I can perhaps think about civic. Or I can just go that, then go for civic, then go for military. And just, I can do it however you can do it however you want to. You can jump back and forth. You can concentrate solely on military or solely on civic. It's totally up to you and how you want to develop your own faction. Next to that, we have trade and finance. You click on that. Gives you a list of different things. So this is the tax level. Have it all the way low, everyone's happy. Have it all the way high, everyone's pissed off. Keep it on normal for now though, just to be safe. Taxes, tells you how much money you're making through taxes, through immigration, population, trade, and other. My total income is 22,000, but as you can see, my total expenditure to my faction is 16,000, which means I'm making a profit of just under 6,000 per turn. As you can see, that number but there, which I'm hovering over right now, matches up with the number up here. That's my predicted income for next turn. The one next to that, current treasury, I have 9,000 denarii. That's the money I have to spend this turn. And next to that, I have food details. Fertility is really good, if I just hover over it. But my buildings is minus 740. And my hordes in my provinces are minus 2. So they have negative effects on my food. And as you can see, tax effects. So public order is minus 4 at the moment. And my growth is 0. Lowest predicted public order next turn, Britannia Superior. And as you can see, minus 35, minus 10. So if I click on that, it will take me all the way to the province of Britannia Superior. And as you can see, we have Londinium, Corinium, and Camulodunum. That's the south of England, basically. That is what this region is. And if you hover over it, as you can see, minus 35, minus 10. So if you go down to the public order section and hover over it, it tells you why. So my religious differences have caused me a problem right now of minus 6. My food's caused me a problem, minus 5. My taxes are causing me a problem with minus 4. And my immigrants are causing me a problem with minus 1. My buildings are making a small difference of plus 5. And my political situation is giving me a boost of plus 1. But obviously the negative outweigh the positive, which is why we're losing minus 10 per turn. Once that red face gets to minus 100, an army will spring up outside one of these three settlements in the province, and they will be a rebel army, which I will have to defeat. But as we know, if you hover over, the food is lower, and you can see the province effects. So growth minus 2, tax rate minus 4. Good springs, my growth plus 3, construction cost minus 15. But the food shortage is causing a problem of minus 5. And then Stonehenge, because Stonehenge is here, it has a effect. So my research rate actually goes up by having that, because it's an historical monument. But like I said, we know the food's a problem. We have 9,000 to spend. This is going to be one of the fronts that we're going to be fighting on, because we're at war with factions that are nearby, or we will be most likely in the near future. So it's important that we build stuff here. Now, any faction that has, or any building that has these plus signs of undeveloped land, mean that I can build new building types in these spaces. So what I can do here, I can go for Carinium, undeveloped land, press that button there, and it now has a construction site. If I hover over a construction site, it will give you a list of buildings available for you to create. Now, food is a problem like we've already established, so I'm thinking about getting something that's going to give me some food. Rally field gives me army recruitment. Local industry just gives me some wealth. A guardhouse actually loses food but helps the public order go up. Or I can go for Latin baptistry, which gives me good public order. It also gives my Latin Christian influence of plus 1, but my maintenance will go down by minus 100. Now if we go back to the region, if we click on it again and go here, I think, yeah, if we go onto the religious part by here, which is next to the angry face, Latin Christian doesn't exist here. It's a mixture of different religions. There's 5 different religions all around here. So food and religion will help this region. So after looking at that, I'm thinking about building a Latin baptistry, because the public order will go up by plus 2 per turn anyway, and the religious influence will actually go up plus 1. So we're going to build that. It's going to cost 2,000 denarii. So click on that. As you can see, we're down to 7,000 denarii in our current treasury. Although, looking at this, we do have fields, which means we can build something for food. It currently has a 1 by it. That's because it's a tier 1 building. You can go up to tier 2 and then to tier 3 with different building types. So we can have a sheep flock. We lose public order and squalor, but we do gain more food. I can go for a cattle herd again. We lose squalor. We gain squalor. We lose public order, but we get more food. Or wheat fields. Again, public order and squalor have a negative effect, but again, food. So food's plus 20 there. It's plus 40 there. Plus 30 there. I'm going to go with the plus 40 and build a cattle herd. So I got 2 buildings being built at Carinium right now, which in 2 turns time will help the public order in this region. Another thing which will help you build public order in a region is having armies. So if I click on Londinium and then you hover down, this is the overview right now. You can actually go on to raise forces or recruit an agent. If I click on raise forces, it gives me a list of different people I can recruit. Now before you do that, check this here. This is your current maximum number of armies. So I have 7 out of 8 active armies, which means I can recruit one more army. Next up, current fleets. I have none fleets out of 4. So I can have 4 more fleets and one more army to supplement my existing armies and fleets. So what I'm going to do is scroll down and have a look at my generals that I have available. So Flavius Honorus Augustus, Taskmaster. He's also my faction leader. He has the crown by there to signify that. Now he's out of favor. Indecisive attacker. He looks quite negative on the cusp of things, doesn't he? You go down, we've got one by here. He's got plus 1 cunning. And he's got war cry. So this guy, Vidius, looks quite good. Although, how old is he? He's 61, which, you know, goes against him. How many years of active service am I going to get him? You want to get a young general. And this guy, the faction leader, is 16. Which means, even though he's got negative traits, we could possibly build him up into being a really, really good faction leader. This guy up here, Maximinus, KDK, do you know what, I'm just going to call him Metellus. He's a relentless attacker, plus 3 morale when attacking. So he's going to be a very good expansionist kind of attacker. He's 37, so not a bad age. So I'm thinking he's probably the best one to go for. If I click on him, click on Raise Army, boom, there he is. So I can pop him into there. As you can see, the public order is just minus 8 now, rather than minus 10. If you hover over the public order, it will now say, at the current rate, there will be a rebellion in 9 turns. So I know I got 9 turns to try and save this region. Now what I can do with this general, if I click on him here, it's automatically giving me a name. So this is the, this is the 9th Legion of Herculia. But you can rename armies. So if you go into this tab here, which says Force Details, click on it. You can then click on the top bar and you can rename it wherever you want to. So if I'm just going to call this the 9th Legion of Dragonheart. There we go. This is a skill tree as well for the army. So as they level up, as you fight battles and level up, you will get different things. So they've already got plus 5 morale and plus 4 replenishment, plus 2 public order for the local province. So they're quite positive traits. Now you can customize the name like I've shown you. You can customize the emblem. So I can go for something different, like a wreath like that. And as I fight battles and level up the army, we have the army by here, rank 1, experience 0. You get that bar up, they rank up, and I can give 2 things then. So I can go for integrity and integrity, or I can go for ammunition and replenishment. And it just goes down another tech tree, basically. And the same for the general then. Next to that tab, you have general details. Click on that, and the same applies here. You rank him up, you fight battles. He's providing a plus 3 when commanding this army, and you can level him up. So he's already got relentless attacker as a... as a trait, it's already green. That's why he's got the plus 3 morale. If I level him up again and click the next level, he'd have plus 6 morale and so forth. So it's exactly the same concept. You can also get him to marry, which will also give him some positive or negative attributes. And you can get him household stuff like household guards and helmets and stuff. And that will also give him a slight buff as well. So this is how you level up some of your generals in the campaign. Now, speaking of generals and agents and stuff, if you click on the faction, which is right in the center of the screen right here, you click on it, it brings you an overview of your family. So this is my faction leader, Flavius. It shows his wife, Maria. You click on her. As you can see, she's a negative wife. Minus 2 cunning for the husband, plus 1 for personal influence. So she pretty much crosses it out with a positive and a negative trait. And as you can see, they do have a daughter, Horatia, over here. Next to him, Flavius Stilcho. He is the heir. That's why he has the silver crown above his head. And if you hover over things, loyalty, 8 out of 10. So that's what that little ring does there. Heir to the throne, plus 2. Power and Imperium, plus 1. Personal loyalty, plus 6. But he gets minus 1 then for traits and household spouse. So household spouse, this wife by here. As you can see, you hover over, that shows you the loyalty. But they get minus 1 loyalty. But her personal influence is really good. So she's not a bad wife, really. But they have a daughter as well, who is 18. That's the daughter we tried marrying earlier. She was in my family, so I could try and marry her off to someone. Protective, so plus 1, plus 10 agent defense, but then plus 5 hostile agent success chance, so a variation of things there. And other patricians here, so these are all different people in your court, basically. And what you can do, if you hover over some of them, you'll see this military court thing flash up. So Hilarius, but here, if I click on him, I can pop him into my military court, and that will give him a slight buff in replenishment, recruitment cost, and personal influence. Next turn, he will be there. If he levels up, I can then put him to Master of Soldiers. Keep leveling up until you can get someone to be Master of Officers. And as you can see, you get very good buffs the higher up you go. And that's how that works there. Now, Dominion is here. If that's your power and influence over your domain, basically. I have your power. So my power is acceptable right now. So it's a variation of positive and negative traits. If I do poorly in the campaign, that will start to slow down. If I do really well, my Imperium goes up, my power goes up as well. So you've constantly got to battle that. And the same with your overall control. If events will pop up on the screen every turn or every few turns. If you make good decisions, that goes up. If you make bad decisions, that goes down. And basically, your power and overall control in the campaign is a combination of all three. So keep an eye on that on a turn basis, every turn, basically. Now, next to this, you've got governors. I can assign 4 altogether. I have many different regions. And as we know, Britannia is a problematic region. So Britannia Inferior and Superior are going to be the regions I look at to probably govern, because I'm going to try and hold that region if possible. So Vidius Flavianus, if I click on him, he's available to be a governor. I'm going to pop him in Britannia Inferior. There we go. He's going to be a governor there now. I have a couple of here. I got Anatolius. If I click on him, I'm going to pop him in now Britannia Superior. As you can see, it does cost money to make a governor. This costs 525 denarii. Pop him there. So I'm just going to make 2 governors for now. And click OK. And what that means is, if you have a governor, so Britannia Superior has one, we now have this tab right here, provincial edicts. Four of them are available. I can only pick one edict, so I can have research rate plus two, religious influence plus four, which is going to be tempting because we do know this region has bad influence. Ecumenical matter, so corruption and religious influence again, that affects that. Food production and public order, that's going to be an interesting one. Or auxiliary support. So I've got a choice. I either go for the food, which we need, and the public order, which we need, or I go with the religion, which we also need. I'm going to go with religion, but really it's a flip of the coin between either two for this particular province. Now we have 4,000 or so left to spend. I haven't shown you how to recruit yet, so I'm going to do that now. I'm going to show you up here though at Eboracum. Now Eboracum, if I show you it here, is part of Britannia Inferior. It has Segontium in North Wales and Lindum down here in the Mercian lands. And that is the region of three different settlements in one province. Again, we can have edicts issued here. I'm going to do the whole religious thing again for this region because I have a governor now here. But because this is a walled settlement in Eboracum, that is my region capital, the same as Londinium is the regional capital in the south of England. And again, you know, minus 40, but only minus 1 up here, so not quite as bad. But as you can see, the military presence is plus 4, and the military presence is this faction here. And they are depleted, look at that. They are suffering attrition. Only the General Sextus has a full bill of health. The rest are all 50%. So we're going to supplement this army. Now, by clicking on him and bringing the army up, I have a choice. I can put him into a forced march, which means he can traverse the land at a slightly quicker pace. Although, if he gets attacked, he will be taking a hit. So it's best to keep him into a none stance, basically. You can do other stuff, though. You can have, if you move him around the campaign map, you can put him into a raiding stance. That's really useful if you're a Viking forefather faction and you're in the scene trying to raid certain ports, or you can put them into an ambush stance. So if you're in a narrow corridor somewhere, like in Wales, for example, and a faction, an army rather, is coming down here, you can perhaps catch them in an ambush, and you can get them then in a decent battle where you are the favourable faction in that battle. What I'm going to do now, though, with this legion, I'm going to show you how to recruit. So click on Recruit Units. I have three available for me in the region. I can go for the Border Guards, the Cohorts, or the Levies. Now, on the left-hand side, you'll see it tells you about each one. So the Levies have low ammunition, very poor armour, but they have an excellent rate of fire. The Cohorts have excellent armor, average missile block chance, but they have poor armor piercing. And then the Border Guards are excellent armor, good attack against cavalry, and average missile block. The Border Guards are definitely the better unit, and they also cost the most. So we're going to go with them. And I think we'll get as many as we can, which is four. We're going to get four Border Guards in this province here. And we're going to look at Londinium. We'll click on them. And the same thing applies here. Now we can get the Border Guards here. And again, I can get three this time, so I'll get three there. And that's the military. You can also get mercenaries, so if you click on hire mercenaries, it tells you what's available in the region. So we've got Celtic Band, Celtic Axe Band, Celtic Skirmishers. We're going to get lots of Celtic units up here. Now if you were to go elsewhere on the map, so if I show you this army here, if I click onto the mercenaries here, different types of units are here. So you've got Germanic Warband, Hunters, Hurlers, but in this region, can't currently recruit them. But that will change on a regular basis. So this region here, exactly the same type of units there. I believe I do have armies in North Africa. Let me just double check. I do, at Constantina. Click on this army here. Mercenaries, again, different types. Desert Legionary, Desert Bowman. So depending on where you are in the world, you get different types of mercenaries. Now I'm hoping to show you a battle in this tutorial before we end things off. I've shown you most of the stuff on the campaign map here. If there is anything you need me to go over again, I don't mind making a follow-up video to this, a part two. I know what I am showing you. So up the top here, we have the Imperial Legion. This just goes over the stuff we saw at the start of the campaign. So it tells you your upkeep. It's what's on the faction splash page as you start a campaign. So all of that's up here. My power, so you can quickly look at your power here rather than going into this and looking at it. Just a quick highlight if you're in a bit of a rush. Latin Christian, so it tells you what your religion is. My Imperium is inspiring, but I have a great power, major diplomatic penalty with most factions because of that. And my food surplus. So I have a slight food surplus, but it's important that I try and keep that going. As you can see, there are certain things on the map, like the walls and stuff, that you can see right now, which are really interesting to look at. But yeah, that's pretty much most of the campaign stuff I've gone through. So what I am going to do now, guys, is click the end turn. That's when, once you're happy with what you've done in your turn, you can just click end turn. Now it says I can still issue a provincial governor. They are the two which I've left out by here. I'm just going to ignore that and just say accept. And this is our end of turn. Now I'm most likely, yep, as expected. Now come the Ravens. This is why you should not play as the Western Roman Empire. Because the Western Roman Empire, no one likes them at the start of this campaign. Lots and lots of land to defend, lots of potential enemies. And as you can see, I got the option to call in my allies, but these allies are not going to be anywhere near me. They're all in the east. I have no friends in the west. So just click OK. And the Ibdanians are at war with me without me doing anything. As expected, they're going to sail across and they're going to attack me. And because they have such strength, I am unable to... well, I could fight it and hope for the best, but I have very little. I have two ships and four units. So I'm just going to auto-resolve this for the sake of showing you a poor battle. You can auto-resolve by clicking auto-resolve like I just did. It gives you three different stances. Balanced, defensive, aggressive. And it wasn't in my favour. Now, that battle would have been better for me to have fought it, because I probably would have had a better chance of winning if I had fought it. But, you know, that it would have been unlikely. Now, this one... the auto-resolves give me a slightly better chance, although I'm heavily outnumbered. They have 2,000, we have about 600. So, again, not worth showing. We're just going to be defensive or protective. Hopefully we cut our losses, but we've lost the region by the looks of things. And this is why playing as the Western Roman Empire is extremely difficult. One of the hardest campaigns, not just in this game of Total War, but most Total War games in general. They are the dog's bollocks as far as... a tough campaign goes. This on Legendary, it's no easy task. It is no easy task. And you need to be an experienced player to play this, in my opinion. Now, this one we are going to show, because the balance of power, as you can see, is almost 50-50. We are defending. They have nearly 2,000. We are up against it. Most of my men are depleted. We do have some reinforcements here. So I'm going to show you the scout terrain feature. So you click on that. It brings up the terrain, the type of battlefield that you will be fighting. It should load up in a few moments. There we go. So the red zone is where they deploy. Yellow zone inside there is a settlement and where I deploy. You can auto-resolve, like I said. You can sally forth, which means you'll fight in an open field battle, which is insane against this army. Or you can just fight in the settlement. We're going to fight in the settlement, so we're going to click the fight in the battlefield. So here we go. And it tells you then, so I'm a level one star general. They got a one star general. I have a garrison army helping up my main army. Now, the good thing with defensive battles is, in a lot of the settlements you do defend, there will be some towers, and towers do lots of damage. So, this is going to be the actual battle inside of the game now, which I'm going to be showing you. I'm going to go over some basic commands as well, and generally show you a good way to set up in defensive battles. Now, it doesn't always go that way, and the one thing I would recommend any battle you fight, whether it's a multiplayer battle or a battle against the AI or a campaign battle, is try to kill their general as early and quickly as you can in a battle. Killing a general gives the enemy a massive penalty. It's like 40% minus or 50% minus. It's a massive hit. Now, this is the campaign map right here. And on the map, if I bring up large on the tactical map up here, this gives you an overview of the entire map. As you can see, the red bar there is where the enemies start off. We can see them there. If I click the back, you'll see. So I know that they're going to be coming from that area over there. Now, the yellow bar here is a tower. This tower is going to constantly fire upon them until it gets destroyed. The same with this tower by here. Now, I don't want them to come in. And as you can see, barricades remaining one. Now, any of these areas that have these little transparent yellow kind of barricades show me where I can place it. So if I click by there, a barricade will be put there. Now, that wouldn't be really wise, because they're going to be attacking from this side rather than this side. So I'm thinking up here somewhere would be advisable. Now, I could put them here, I think. Let me just click back off that. I click it there. Now, that would be advisable, because they've got the tower in the way there, and I could just defend from this flank. So that's what I'm going to do. Now, if I click Control A, I can select all my units. Just going to move them away slightly, just so I can organize myself. Now, what I like to do is group up all my certain unit types. So we have bows here, I like my bows to be at the front to do extra damage. So I'm just going to pop them by the tower. And I'm going to get them set up so they can ambush the enemy. So Pathfinding's a bit of a bitch right now. But they should be okay where they are. Now I'm going to put them on skirmish mode, which is by here. That means that once the enemy gets to a certain range, they will run away. But they will pelt them as much as they can in the meantime. I'm also going to put them onto flaming arrows. As you can see, I have a better base damage as a bonus against cavalry. I do believe they have some cavalry units here. They do have two. Just going to do that and keep them there. Now, I have lots of spears, so all I'm going to do, click on the spears and hold on control so I can select multiple ones by clicking. And then I'm going to do control and G, and that groups them up into a group. So I just got a selection of those three. I can just press one now as well, so I click off. Press one, brings them up. So I can select them with the one or just by clicking. And I can put them wherever I want. Now, spears are a good defensive unit, and as you can see, I can do stationary testudo. If I zoom in right here now and show you the units, this is what it's like now. And just get a bit closer, basically. And I can do that with all of them. So all three of these would be wise to put them at the front line, wouldn't it? So I'm thinking along here, perhaps. If it lets me. Now, a bit of a gap by here, unfortunately, which I don't think is going to let us go around. But I'm thinking if we can just fill that gap slightly more. That'll have to do for now. We can always advance them forward if we need to. So we've put them there to hold the center. We'll have the tower there, and we've got the missiles there. That should be pretty good. And we've also got the natural barricade there and another tower to do damage. So I'm just thinking of where I can maximize the kill ratio. I want my general nearby as well. So I'm going to put him just by here. I got some sword units. And also, if you click on a unit in Attila, you'll see a little green and little red box, or triangle rather. Sword units are good against the Germanic brigands, and they have quite a few of them, and bows, but they are weak against everything else. My general is good against everything else apart from the axemen and their general. My spears are good against most of their units apart from their axemen and their general. My bows are good against most of their units apart from their general and their brigands. So it varies. So you want to try and get the right troops attacking their troops. Otherwise, if you get that wrong, then it could cause problems. So what I'm just going to do now is group up the remainder of my troops. So get my cavalry grouped up. I'm thinking about using them perhaps on the left flank. So I'm just going to put them by here. I'll run them out then. Actually, because they're cavalry and they're a certain troop type, I can start them off outside the yellow deployed zone and into the red. So I'm just going to run them up here and try and go around to flank. So I'm going to do that in one movement. Now my swords are going to be grouped up. They'll be in group three, and they're going to be as a support troop, basically. There's going to be, but they can run in and support the spears as they get pelted there. And then all I have left then is another, actually I got to put him with them as well. I've got to put him there. Yep. What am I doing, guys? Well, let's sort this out. Let's do this properly. Okay, so we've got three swords in reinforcement range there, and I have more skirmishers here, light skirmishers, which I'm just going to group into their own group, put them on skirmish as well, and they are going to be utilized just behind, because they're going to be firing over their heads and onto the oncoming enemy. So that's my plan. I've just worked out and formulated a plan here, and hopefully it will work out. So what I'm going to do is click the start battle button. I'm going to run my cav straight to that left flank. I'm going to push these forward until they can actually cover a bit more ground. I'm going to click R. So they walk. I've got to put them out of Testudo first, though, for them to actually walk. That's the only negative with that. I just want to make sure that I've got my troops in decent position here. So I'm going to spread out my bows or my missiles there. I'm going to push my swords up slightly. I'm going to try and get them in this corridor, because if I can do that, that's going to be pretty decent. And my general's behind then as extra cover if need be. Just going to use him there. Now, it looks like the axemen are being attracted to my cavalry over here. I don't mind that, because that's going to pull me away. Now, some things that you can do, if you click on a unit, if you press the insert button, it gives you unit cam, so you can get the nice graphics like this. Now, on unit cam, you can zoom in by holding on the left mouse button. Press spacebar for manual control look. You can press page up and page down, and that will move you to a different man in the unit. So that's cool, isn't it, guys? Press insert again just to come out of it like that. You can also press K. That gets rid of all the UI stuff, so I can zoom in, look. If I want to do this sort of thing. hold on the mouse wheel while pressing Z. Put Z, well, not Z, rather K. K I meant. Put K back on to do that. Now I should be concentrating on the battle, so let's concentrate on the battle. As you can see, not going too well, is it? We have spears there, but it's not quite going to plan. Let's concentrate on the actual battle. So first of all, select these guys. They're going to attack over there. Now we have some men coming around the side by here. Now my cav, just being idle for no reason at all, can actually attack and try and take out those brigands for me. That tower's going to try and do some damage. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to be sending some of my missiles to attack like so. And I'm going to use my swords to actually charge in and try and supplement and support them that are getting attacked at there. Now this isn't the best of plans. We are heavily outnumbered, but it is possible that we can do something well here. We do have some light axes that are getting attacked from behind by my tower right now, which is good. We have some cav which will be charging in, which we can take out their bows by there. That'd be nice. Unfortunately, we lost that tower, so we're not getting that attack on them anymore. But my cav is going to mop up and clean up these brigands here, and they can also attack these guy here. Now, my general's actually attacking the Germanic band here. He does have a special ability, which is Raise Banner. That gives him a plus melee defense, which is probably a wise thing to give to himself. So I click on that. His melee defense has gone up. And now what I can do now, my cav can mop up the brigands here, which they are murdering. Their unit has rallied. And we can actually come back and attack. I'm actually going to tell one of the cav to charge them from behind. Now we are holding our ground up here. It could be going a bit better, but we are holding and we are getting attacks. I'm going to tell all my bows just to aim for the general. Like I said, killing the general first and early is what you need to be doing. This unit isn't attacking as well as it could, so let's get them in there like that. And as you can see, one of the axes is actually going now. My other cav unit is going to run up here, and it's going to actually charge and try and mop up around the side up there. So I'm actually doing pretty well now. It's fighting back. We're doing well. Let's actually get some of these units. By clicking the right button, you actually issue an attack order. I didn't explain that earlier. I do apologize, guys. I should have done that, but I'm doing it now. So click on them with the left. Right click to attack. Let's get the cav to go up there and charge them. As you can see, they are routing. Many of them are wavering. Some of them are routing. This cav's going up the flank now. It's going to charge the bows. Cav onto bows is really good. Very favorable for us. Now these three, put them off skirmish and get them attacking that general. I have a sword unit behind you, which can act as another line of defense. Now my general needs to be up here in support as well. As a matter of fact, he needs to get going because he's got some spears on the way here. Now spears don't like bows, so I'm going to put my general by here. I'm going to put him in a mobile testudo. You can have the testudo over there. And then the sword can charge in like so. Now my cav can go around the flank and help out. I got one cav unit which is taking out Germanic bows. I've taken the attention of this bow unit. Unfortunately, they're hitting the back of my cav, but if we can get them away from the main battle, which is the center by here, that is great. For some reason, my cav's glitching and going right through. Why the hell are they doing that? I don't know. Do not know why. But they have charged through nonetheless, which is okay, I suppose. And they can go after the bows over there. Now, it's neck and neck so far, as you can see, still slightly in the favor of the enemy. But if you hover over this, it shows you the kill count and how things are actually going. Get my general to charge in and attack. You can actually assist rather than standing like a bystander. More of their units are actually routed now, which is very favorable for me as well. So we're doing pretty damn well. As you can see, they have some cav charging in. And you can zoom in, you can see the action if you want to. If you've got a good PC, I definitely recommend doing that. But as I'm commentating at the same time of me doing this, it can be quite difficult sometimes to multitask like that. So I'm just kind of doing it on the hip right now as we go through this battle. Now it says on the right hand side you get notifications. The men are broken and running for their lives. You'll see that. That's because the Sagittari has just been routed by the cav. And we haven't got many men left, have we? It's very nip and tuck at the moment. Very nip and tuck. And that's not good. And they have some Germanic levies come back. I've got two cav. Routed both their men. Let's group them up together quickly. We're going to go for a little rear charge on the Germanic nobles there. So let's get a rear charge going. We have them outflanked by here. Just got those spears to hold them off as long as they can. We are getting killed, which is the important thing. Let's actually get my general up here now. He's needed in the thick of things. He is definitely needed in the thick of things. And there we go, little charge in the back of the general. He's got some kills on him there. Down to 80, down to 90, and he's actually losing quite a lot. He's outflanked now. They're sending a cavalry unit into the back to try and salvage the day here. But hopefully it'll be just enough. They are exhausted. And if we can get a kill on him very quickly, that would be fantastic for us. I'm going to send as many troops in as I can now, because I do feel like the victory could be ours. We've routed off most of their men now. The main battle's up here. I'm actually going to tell my cav to charge back out. Let's get them out of there, because if they stay there for too long, they will sustain a lot of damage. Let's get them out. And then we'll go for a second charge. Get that charge bonus going. As you can see, my bows are actually firing over the top of this building and into them there. And it's actually in our favour now, so we're doing pretty damn well. And their general's actually routing now. And because their general's routing, that means that we should be relatively easy. I'm going to tell my bows just to turn around, not to fire on my own men, because that would be suicidal. And as you see, the balance power is heavily in my favour. Most of their men are running. Once that general dies, this will probably be the end of the battle. And as you can see, he's starting to go. Get them all to attack him. Issue them all to attack him like so. Get my general back here. Oh, and he's actually found an enemy. He's decided to fire on us. I'm perfectly happy with that. That's not a problem at all. The enemy general is, and there we go. Enemy general's dead, like I said. And now they'll all start to go. Got one wavering by them. Got one wavering by here. We just tell all these to run out and attack him. Germanic levy should be gone. And then the Germanic brigands are getting fired upon by my bows. You can actually fast forward the battle on the top right. You got forward and it got fast forward, which is triple speed. But victory is ours. So you can chase them down if you want to, or you can end battle. I'm just going to click end battle. It's a Pyrrhic victory. That means that I won, but at a great cost. And we know that because we have barely any men left. So a very good victory, considering they doubled our men and we were half depleted at the start of the battle. So it was a damn good victory. I don't know whether I could have pulled that off on legendary or not. It would have been a lot harder. But as it was on normal, I had a bit more chance to do it. And as you can see, only one unit really was unscathed. That was the cohorts. I have three options. I can ransom and release. I get a bit of money by lose integrity. Take on warriors, I would replenish. Or I can just kill them. I'm going to take on warriors and replenish because I need the replenishment. And that's basically how battles work. That was a defensive battle. We won. That's a good kind of rundown. Now, settlement been sacked. If you click on the zoom to location, it will tell you where. You can do that with anything. Office secured. That's the offices we did earlier. And yeah, that is pretty much how Total War Attila works. That's the core mechanics, that's the campaign map and the battle. I will do a follow-up if it is requested by you guys. If there's anything at all you need me to go over, let me know in the comment section below. And also check out my other tutorial videos on Medieval 2, Shogun 2 and Rome 2 for a basic guide on how to play those games as well. I've been Dragonheart, the Prince of Wales. Thank you for watching. Until next time, goodbye.